You are watching a video in the lecture series of Botanypedia to help you learn about various concepts of biology. I am Dr. Pavan Kumar, and in this lesson we are going to learn about basic principles of microscopy. In this class we are going to learn about various aspects of microscopy. First we will have an introduction to the microscopy, then we will look at the historical breakthroughs that happened in this particular area. Then we will see the basic design of a compound like microscope and how it functions, taking the example of a ray diagram. Then we will look at the principle of magnification and resolution. Let's have an overview of this technique. A microscope is an instrument that is used to visualize objects that are difficult to be seen with the naked eye. These are the some pictures of light microscope. On the left hand side you can see how a slide is being mounted on a stage of a light microscope to visualize its image, and on the right hand side you can see a picture of compound light microscope. Now let's have a snapshot of the major historical breakthroughs that happened in this area. In 1519, the Jacques Janssen used multiple lenses in a tube to observe objects. In 1609, it was Galileo Galilei who developed a compound microscope with a convex and a concave lens. Thereafter, in 1625, a first use of term microscope came into existence. It was Giovanni Faber who coined this term. In 1665, Robert Hooke published his work in Micrographia, where he coined the term cells. He observed a honeycomb pattern, and the term cells came from that pattern. In 1676, living cells were first seen by Leeuwenhoek. He built a simple microscope with one lens to examine blood, yeast and insects. In 1874, one of the very famous equation, Abbe's equation, was proposed by the Ernst Abbe, who gave a formula to correlate resolving power to that of the wavelength of light. Now we will look at the various components of a compound light microscope. Here on the left hand side is a picture of a typical compound light microscope that is routinely used in schools and colleges and even in the higher institutions. So the components of a compound light microscope can be categorized in two ways. We will first look at the structural components and then we will look at the optical components. The first part of the structural component is base that supports the microscope and houses the illuminator. Then we have the arm that connects to the base and supports the microscope head. Then we have the head that houses the most of the optical parts of the compound light microscope. Now we will look at the optical parts of a compound light microscope. Starting from the top, we have at number one, eyepiece. It is the lens at the top that we look through, and it usually has 10x to 15x power. It is then followed by eyepiece tube, and it holds the eyepiece lens at a fixed distance from the objective lens. Then we have body tube. The function of the body tube or the purpose of having the body tube is to separate the objective and the eyepiece so that there is a proper alignment. Then we have the most important part in a compound light microscope. It is the coarse focus knob. It is the knob that is used to focus the specimen, and it can move the stage up and down so that the specimen comes into the focus. Once the specimen comes into the focus, we need to fine tune the specimen, and for doing that we have the fine focus knob, and it brings the specimen into sharp focus under low power. Then we have objective lenses, and the primary objective lenses can range from 4x to 100x. In our subsequent slide, we will learn or understand what 4x and 100x actually means. Then we have at number 7 is stage and the mounting clip. As the name suggests, it is the place where the specimen is kept and viewed under the microscope. Then we have the condenser. It will collect and focus the light from the reflector onto the specimen, and it is located just below the stage, and it is in often conjunction with an iris diaphragm. Iris diaphragm is there to control the amount of light that is undergoing this particular condenser. Then we have the reflector. To understand the functioning of a compound light microscope, we will now draw a ray diagram. So this is a picture of a light microscope on the left hand side, and we will draw the ray diagram on the right hand side. The first oval circle that you see on the right hand side is of a reflector. So, and this is the line through which the light ray will pass through. Now this is the condenser, which is a convex lens. So the light rays which are coming from the reflector, after reflection they undergo refraction and they are focused, and they pass through the specimen. The specimen here is denoted by a blue arrow. After crossing the specimen, these light rays further reach objective lens. The amount of light collected by the objective lens will depend upon the aperture of the objective lens. So once the light rays are incident on the objective lens, they undergo a second round of refraction, where after refraction they intersect at a particular point. So this is the point where intermediate image is formed. After crossing this point of intersection, these light rays further reach eyepiece, and after undergoing the third round of refraction, they appear to get diverged. So when we try to look at from the eyepiece, we see that these light rays are coming from the backward direction, from a point of intersection. So this is the point of intersection where the final magnified virtual image is formed. Now let us understand what is the principle of magnification. Magnification means to what an extent a microscope can produce an enlarged image of an object. It is also known as linear magnification. Light microscope can magnify up to 400 times the actual size. Magnification, maximum magnification till date that can be achieved by a compound microscope is 1500x. There is a formula to calculate the magnification. We can calculate it by using this formula, which is M is equal to image size divided by object size. If a microscopic lens has a magnification of 4x, it simply means that the lens can produce images that are 4 times larger than the object. The final magnification, which is denoted by MF here, produced by a compound microscope is actually the product of magnification of the eyepiece lens and the objective lens. So we can see that MF is equal to ME multiply MO. Magnifying power, on the other hand, is different from the linear magnification, and it is also known as angular magnification, and that is defined as the ratio of the angles subtended by the object and the image. Now we will look at the principle of resolution, and to understand this we must understand what is Abbe's equation that was given by Ernst Abbe in 1874. According to this equation, D is equal to 1 upon RP is equal to 0.61 lambda divided by n sine theta. In some books you will see that the it is written in the form of RP. So if you just take the RP on this side and D on this side, these will get inverted. So it really doesn't matter which way you are writing, but I think the concept of this equation should be clear. So if you take D, it is the limit of resolution, and it is defined as the minimum distance between two points that allow their discrimination. RP refers to resolving power, and it is the ability to clearly distinguish two points that are close together, and it is also known as resolution. N sine theta, the whole term, is known as numerical aperture. It is the ability of an objective lens to collect the amount of light, and that will depend upon the aperture of the objective lens. It is important here to mention that the N is the refractive index of the medium, and it greatly influences the resolving power of the microscope. Angular aperture is defined as the half of the angle of the cone of light that is subtended by the object. So, and the lambda here refers to the wavelength of light that is used for illumination. There are some conclusions that we can draw from this equation, that the resolution, or we can say resolving power, is inversely related to the wavelength of light. It is directly proportional to the refractive index of the medium, and it is also directly proportional to the numerical aperture. In other words, we can say that also. And then we have the fourth conclusion, that the resolving power is inversely related to limit of resolution. Now, if we take air as a medium, then what will be the limit of resolution of a compound light microscope? So to understand this, we will take the help of a numerical problem. So let's read the numerical problem first. Calculate the limit of resolution of a compound microscope when a specimen was illuminated by blue light. Why we are taking a blue light here? I will explain this thing in a bit. So this wavelength, this light has a wavelength of 450 nanometer, where the angular aperture theta was 70 degree. And air was taken as a medium between the specimen and the objective lens. Now, for the sake of simplicity, the value of sine theta is already provided. So we will first solve this numerical. We will calculate the value of D, that is the limit of resolution, and then we will interpret the answer. So let's look at the problem again and see what are the values that are already provided. We see that the value of lambda is given, and that is 450 nanometer. We have the value of theta, which is 70 degree, and then we have the value of refractive index that we already know is 1. So using the formula of numerical aperture, which is n sine theta, we can calculate the value of Na. Now we need to calculate the limit of resolution. To do so, we will use the Abbe's equation, and we will substitute these values in this equation, and after solving we get the value of D equals to 292.02 nanometer. Now, as we know that the resolution is inversely related to the wavelength of light from this the equation, and we also know that it is directly related to the limit of resolution, there is some interpretation that we can arrive at. Therefore, the blue light having the shorter wavelength of light will give the better resolution, because lower will be the value of lambda, higher will be the resolution, because there is an inverse relationship between these two terms. The best objective lens that are available in the market, they have maximum value of theta equals to 70 degree. So that's why we took the example of 70 degree as a value of angular aperture in the question. So if we keep these parameters or conditions and we calculate air, we calculate the resolving power taking air as a medium, we see that the limit, maximum limit of resolution that is possible, is up to 292 nanometer. So now you must be thinking that if we want to further increase the limit of resolution, what we can do? We can increase the resolving power of a compound light microscope by using immersion oils. And to understand this, we must understand these two diagrams first. So I am taking two cases here. First is case A, and then we have the case B. So this is a illustration of how specimens are mounted on a stage, and what is the area of focus that we need to look at to understand how immersion oils and hence the resolving power. So in case A, let's first read what these different segments of this illustration diagram explains. First, this is the condenser, then we have the slide, and this is your specimen that is mounted here, that is your cover slip, and this is the area which is between the objective lens and the cover slip. So this area, that is this is the medium, and if this medium is air, then we know that the refractive index of the air is 1. And if we replace this air with a drop of immersion oil, which can be a paraffin oil or it can be a cedar wood oil, then the value of n will increase from n equals to 1 to n is equal to 1.5. And from this equation, we know that the resolving power is directly proportional to n. So if you are keeping all the other parameters same, and if you increase the value of n, you will definitely get a better resolution. So now we will look at the same numerical problem, but in this case, we are taking immersion oil as a medium between the specimen and the objective lens. And if we do the calculation in the same way that if we do the calculation in the same way as we did in the previous numerical, we see that the value that we obtain for the limit of resolution has changed to 194.68. Why the value has changed? Because we have changed the value of n to 1.5. So now, if you notice here that with the immersion oil, the limit of resolution has changed to 194 nanometer. This means that if two points are situated as close as 194 nanometer, we can now see those points very clearly. With air as a medium, this value was 292 nanometer, meaning that microscope can only produce clear images of two objects that are situated only up to the limit of 292 nanometer. So if the points are closer than 292 nanometer, we would see a blurry image so that they appear as a single point. Remember that the limit of resolution is inversely related to resolution. So here we are taking the example of the value of D to understand how the resolution is affected. Hence, the lower the value of limit of resolution, better would be the resolving power. So if we compare the results from both the cases, we see that the value has changed from 292 to 194 nanometer. And we can conclude here that if we want to increase the resolution of a microscope, we must choose a wavelength of light which has a smaller wavelength, and we must choose a medium which has a higher refractive index. Here in this case, we are taking immersion oil, and we must have the numerical aperture which is n sine theta. It should be larger. So the numerical aperture is something that the companies will make when they are designing the objective lenses. These are the some suggested readings. These are two chapters that you can read from two different books. I thank my research mentor, Professor Sudeshna Mazumdar-Layton, Department of Botany, University of Delhi, for introducing me to the world of research and teaching. I thank my teachers, Professor S.B. Babba, Department of Botany, University of Delhi, who taught me this technique in detail during my master's course. And I also thank Dr. Manju A. Lal for teaching me the fundamental concepts of microscopy at undergraduate level. If you like this lesson, you can hit the like button. You can also subscribe to my channel Botanypedia. If you want to receive a copy of this presentation, you can also drop a message in the comment section below. Thank you for watching this lesson. I wish you a great success.